we'd like to thank Katerina and Arthur as well for
having
us here today and populating their house with all of us. And we thought the best thing to do first off was just to let you know what our plans are over the next 2 weeks, so that you know what's going on. We've decided that we're going to, this Wednesday and the following Wednesday, meet back here sometime after 4 o'clock on those 2 days. And we'll just go through to whatever time it takes us through to, or whatever time Mary and I feel like we need, want to go home and go to bed. Then there's 2 weekends that we'll be here, and at this stage only one of those weekends had been planned to have the meetings at the school. It's a school hall, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, that most of the guys in Greece have been given the address to, but the guys from that are travelling in probably are not sure of the addresses aside from what's been given today.
Yeah, just the map.
Yeah. So what we're thinking of is actually doubling that up and actually doing it the following weekend as well. So
if that's okay with panels, to have the sound equipment again.
Yep.
Would that be right?
Yep.
Because all we need is a mixer, speakers, and...
Speakers are already in the venue.
Oh, awesome.
They accommodate an amplifier and a speaker, so yeah, we have the other stuff.
Yeah, we brought all of our
YouTube
gear and everything.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so...
We have mules.
We have drunk mules.
You know,
no, not drunk mules.
sound equipment mules. Brought by different
ones. All the different people who have brought part of the equipment. So
we'll be okay.
So that'll be alright for the following weekend?
Yeah,
that'll be good.
We'll be happy.
Yeah. We just thought there's more people coming next weekend and then the following weekend as well.
More
so
people coming again. So
yeah, it might just be comfortable to have space and facilities, and it's not as much drain on Katerina's and Arthur's home. So,
So that's our general plan. Aside from that, we have no plans. And in terms of what we talk about, we have no plans as well. So that's going to be very dependent on what you guys want to talk about, really.
We wanted to have today to get to know you. Lots of you, I met once very briefly when I first met AJ, so I was really shy, angry, shut down. And others of you I've met over the internet and things. And some of you I see all the time.
I won't ask any questions.
But also, I think it's lovely to get to know you, but also that you have the opportunity to meet some people that we do see all of the time and share that experience.
So aside from that, as I said, aside from that, we don't have any plans in terms of what to talk about. So we're happy to... have you decide the subjects of which you want to discuss or ask questions about? So basically that's what we wanted to do today. We were just thinking of just getting to know you guys better, you know, particularly those of you who we haven't met before, but also those of you who we're reacquainting ourselves with. Just to get to know things better and how things have been going over the last 3 years since we saw you last. Yeah. Because it's almost, it is 3 years since we saw you last.
3 years and a couple of months. So
that's what we feel.
What do you feel?
What do you feel?
Is there anyone here who's never seen a DVD or never had anything to do with us before?
Yep.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you? And we have some free DVDs, don't we? I think Joy brought a whole box of... We sent a box, didn't we, Joy?
We sent two boxes. One's arrived.
One's arrived.
Hopefully the other one's still on the way.
Still on the way. So there's what, about 40?
There's 40
in
sets.
That, 40 sets. And they're all remastered sets, aren't they?
Yes.
So some of you who already have some sets of DVDs may like to get some of those sets anyway. Because they're all remastered, and one of the talks on there you would never have seen probably. It's a talk about faith. Yeah,
that you did last year.
That we did last year.
It's never been made into a DVD before.
So at the moment, we're starting to make a lot of what we did last year into masters. When I say we, definitely not me. It's Igor, and who's doing a lot of the mastering, and then Joyce getting the production sorted out. And so what we're hoping to do is get a lot of those DVDs that haven't been presented from last year on the internet, at least. They're already being loaded on YouTube now. So for those of you who have not seen any of last year's talks at all, you might want to have a look on YouTube. If you've got a fast internet connection, you'll probably be able to watch it straight off of YouTube.
And there's very recent ones just from last month on there now as well.
We haven't got all of the last years on YouTube yet, have we, Igor?
No.
No. But we're getting close now, anyway. So, and then once they're finished being loaded on YouTube, we'll then produce DVDs for them as well. So, they'll all be loaded first, and then we'll load the older ones. Yeah. So that's our plans to do that. And the feeling I have is many of you guys have questions about a lot of things.
Yeah.
So just fire away, eh?
From speaking with everyone, I feel that this topic about God is huge, connecting to God and building this connection. Mm-hmm. And I was just mentioning to Isabella earlier that before I got on this path, I used to feel, whenever I would see a sunset, and I used to feel so close to God and so connected, and I felt that it was a painting just for me, and every day was something different. I used to cry and feel so close. And now, 2 years later, I look up and I feel nothing. It's like we dig, and then we get to like a titanium coffin that doesn't
yes.
want to open,
I
this
agree.
Sort of thing. And I know that it comes from oppression that I felt from my parents of being projected at, about being perfect, and just panic and fear all the time.
Yeah.
So, just like I'm feeling right now. And I just want to be able to build that, because I know it's really important. Mm. And it's the key. And I think that a lot of us have this struggle with, we want to feel so close, we really want this. And the projections are so huge, and they're so good at manipulating, they're like professionals, you know, they just take you out of it.
Very true.
I just wanted to ask about this,
yep.
and give some insight
into that. No, that's a good question. And the feelings I have a lot are that when you initially discover God, there's a lot of joy generally. And then you get confronted with yourself. And the confrontation with yourself is very, very difficult. And the deeper you go into the confrontation with yourself, the harder it becomes. So initially... myself a very love story.
It's perfect. There's sun, there's beach, there's halva, there's...
Tropical weather.
Yeah. But this confrontation with yourself is the most difficult part of the journey. And what we finish up doing is we finish up losing, but often in the confrontation with yourself, you finish up losing your passion and desire for God. And this is something to be very conscious of, about, in that if you allow the confrontation with yourself to become so overwhelming, you can actually finish up detuning from everything around you because the confrontation with yourself is so hard. Or you can focus on it in a totally different way. You can focus on your desires and passions and then just allow the confrontation with yourself to occur. So what we find a lot of people doing is they're trying to get into emotions, into this confrontation with themselves, trying to feel, you know, what their real core emotions are. And often those real core emotions are very, very dark, and they often have a lot of anger associated with them, and then a lot of fear associated with them, and then lots of grief that we're afraid to feel associated with those core emotions. But oftentimes what we do is we become so focused on finding those emotions that we forget to live our life. And it's far better, actually, to focus on your passions and desires, discovering your passions and desires, living that, and then allowing the emotions that get confronted to just come up naturally.
Yeah, and actually I feel that's the only way that you truly process emotionally, effectively, you know? Because what is the point of us digging around in all these emotions all of the time. It's, for me, it's to have a connection with God and to connect with myself more fully. Now, if I lose sight of those desires and they're not the things leading me, then there's nothing going to pull me out of that dark pit, is it? I'm just down there going, oh, I've got to feel, I've got to feel, I've got to feel, oh, tell a bit of truth, oh, I've got to feel, you know. But there's no, if I lose sight of the feeling that I want to be as God is on this issue, I want to know God's truth on this issue, I want to connect to God's love, and I actually want to love, I want to be free of this sin or this error that's in me, then if I lose sight of that, then there's nothing pulling me through anyway. And we have noticed recently a number of people just getting stuck in this, it's all about emotions, it's all about emotions. And really it's all about God and being loving. And so, and at times I hit that place where I go, oh, I can't even feel God anymore because there's this horrible emotion that I feel like I'm so pissed off at God that I've even got this, or I feel like there's just no goodness in the world, or I can't find that good thing. But prayer is the thing that usually guides me out of that place. Yeah.
Some of the deepest emotions we have are related to our feelings of hopelessness. You know, there's a lot of hopelessness in this world, you know, where nobody really believes anything's going to change. Nobody really believes that you can have a happy life, really. Everybody is making compromises constantly about their life. They're all trying to just make ends meet, generally. You know, we're caught up in this rat race, and you know, here in Greece you've had a lot of like economic downturn and problems as well, that then just embroils you personally in these economic problems as well. And then as a result of all of those things happening, we become there is so much external pressure to take us away from the core relationships and also following our desires and passions. So it becomes more difficult for us to follow desires and passions when we've got all of these external pressures. And then on top of that, we've got these spirit-based pressures, you know, where there's heavy spirit influence trying to shut us down because they want to keep us in exactly the same place that they've always had us, where they can manipulate us and control us and use us for their ends, and for many of the spirits involved. So you have all this heavy pressure from spirits, you have the heavy pressure from the environment you live in, and then of course you're losing your own desires and passions because you feel so embroiled in your own tough emotions. And as a result of that, you then lose sight of why you're doing all of this. You lose sight of this is all about your connection with God first. My suggestion for people generally is to never lose sight of your passions and desires, and to never lose sight of the fact that this is about your relationship with God and your relationship with yourself and your relationship with your soulmate. In the end, they're the core things that drive me. Like, so my whole life is not driven by anything else other than those things. And if you focus on those things, you will have times where you feel really, really low, because you're going to be confronted with the really dark emotions at some point. You know, the dark emotions that have been on the earth for thousands of years, passed down from generation to generation, they're going to be hard to get out of us. Like, they're going to be hard to come out, you know. But the reality is, if you focus on those three things, you will get to those emotions at some point and release them. And once you get past that point, it's sort of like you're building up and up and up and up, climbing up a hill, and the hardest point when you're climbing a hill or climbing a mountain is the part that's just before the top. Do you follow me? Like, that's the part that's hardest. That's the part that's also requires the most effort. It's usually the steepest as well. And it also, you know, you make very, very slow progress in that part, you know. So where you might have made rapid progress doing, you know, along the hill, you know, you can even run up a lot of the hills before then. Once you get to the cliff face, now we're talking about, you know, ropes and pitons and, you know, like things being jammed into the rock and pulling yourself up, and that's what it feels like. But once you hit the top, after that, and the top part really is no longer having a negative feeling about yourself anymore. That's really, that from that moment on, it becomes a lot easier. But it's the negative feelings we have about ourselves that cause so much to become very, very difficult. And once we get over that point, we might not yet be at one with God, but once we get over that point and we have far less negative feelings about ourselves, from that moment on everything starts to work a lot more smoothly. And so the problem with the human race, though, is that we have so many negative feelings about ourselves. Like, if you think about your own life, you know, just getting up in the morning and looking in the mirror, it's very rare that you have a smiling face looking back at you going, yeah, you're a really nice person, actually. You know, most of the time you look in the mirror and you go, gee, you're looking old, you're looking this and you're looking that, and where's that wrinkle? Yeah, that wasn't there yesterday, and all those kind of things.
Too much, however.
And you know, we sort of get away from the focus of which is, you know, we stop focusing on the fact that this is all about our relationship with God, our relationship with ourself, which includes our soulmate, and learning to passionately live our life in every possible endeavor that we love to explore, and then using the rest of our life just to support that. Does that help any?
It does. It just feels so good. I'm pretty okay with the desires. I feel that that I really know. I love music. I love art and paint, and I feel how it affects me and influences others in a positive way. And I love that, and it makes me feel great. But I know that the moment I decide to be really real with me, then God is like you're gone.
Exactly.
Yeah. It feels that way. It does. It makes total sense. But I feel already that there's so much fear about this.
Remember that every time your desires get shut down, so you think when you looked at, you know, when you looked at the beautiful sunset and had that connection with God, your desires weren't shut down in that moment, right? But every time your desires do get shut down, and often when we look at ourselves, that's when our desires really get shut down. Once our desires are shut down, it's very, very, very hard to have any feelings of love coming out of us for anything, let alone for God. Like, you think about it, if you're with a partner and you're getting into some really dark emotions about yourself, very hard to even have a desire for your partner anymore. Right? And this is the thing we need to realize, is that fear is the thing that suppresses desire. So every time you feel disconnected from yourself, disconnected from joy, disconnected from desire, disconnected from happiness, disconnected from God, focus firstly on what am I afraid of? And it's, if you can focus on what you're afraid of without living in what you're afraid of. Myself and Mary were talking a lot about this yesterday, we feel a lot of people are living in what they're afraid of, mm-hmm. rather than actually feeling their fear in the moment of what they're afraid of. So perhaps I can illustrate the difference between those mm-hmm. two states. The first state, which is to actually live in your fear, is generally, you know what you're afraid of, but you justify the fact that you are afraid of that thing. Does that make sense? So let's say in a simple illustration, let's say we were afraid of driving in Varkiza at peak hour. Right? I understand why you might be afraid of that, given that we just walked across the road yesterday there in peak hour. And it can be, you know, there's a lot of people with very pushy emotions, not many rules going on, and it can be, you know, quite dangerous walking across the road there. Now, why would we feel that's dangerous? Like, so this would be old fears related to something in our lives, right? Now, living in the fear would say, I'm not going to walk across that road between the hours of 4 and 6 p.m.
Because
it is dangerous that time of the day. So I'm not going to drive that time of the day.
So then immediately when I'm living in the fear limits something in my life.
Right.
Does
that
make
sense?
I'm not going to do one.
That as a fact, and then you have to avoid it.
Fear is the truth, and immediately as soon as I do that, there's a limit in my life somewhere.
Right. Yeah. So basically what I'm doing is I'm saying the fear means that particular thing is true from now on in my life. So from now on, so this is where a lot of people are with regard to relationships, right? They've had a series of negative relationships, for example, a series of sad relationships. So they get to the point where they say, oh, I don't want to bite off another relationship. I'm not going to have another relationship because all of my past relationships have been really a bit of a mess, you know, and he's left me eventually anyway. They're always going to leave me, right? And so I don't want to have another, I don't want to bite off a relationship.
The truth is, it's going to be bad.
So there's this belief in the error as true. In other words, I'm believing that all relationships are going to turn out bad, no matter what I do. And just like I might believe that walking across the road at Bucky's from 4 to 6, dangerous thing to do. You know, you might get run over pretty easily there, you know. So I decide, no, I'm not going to do that. I saw one lady there who was basically feeling that she was driving her car. She was like, most of you Greece drivers are very fluid with your driving. Like, you just drive and everything's fine and zippy as if there. But this lady was noticeably different. Like, she was,
I thought she might have not been Greek. She might have been. What am I in?
Probably from another country. But she was so worried. And you could feel her fear imposing that onto her driving and everything that she was doing, right? And that's what often happens in our life, is our fear dictates to us what the next steps are that we're going to take. Now, that's living in your fear. Feeling your fear is totally different to that. Feeling your fear is actually driving down that street at that peak hour time and feeling your panic as you do so. That's feeling your fear. So feeling your feelings in the moment is very, very different than talking about them in the moment. What we see is a lot of people talking about their feelings. So we see a lot of people talking about their feelings, but even while they're talking about them, they're not feeling them. Right? They're just talking about them, but they're not actually feeling them. They want somebody to share in them, or they want somebody to experience or commiserate with them at the same time.
Especially fear is very much like that. If you think about your experience of fear, very often we want someone to commiserate with us and say, yeah, it's scary, isn't it? Or to lessen our fear, like to reassure us. Or the very act of talking about fear is very often based, well, it is always based in the unwillingness to actually experience
fear. Yeah. Feel it. And the problem with the suppression of the feeling of fear is that you will also now suppress all your desires. So in other words, you're now shutting down your whole system, emotional system. And from that moment on, you are only going to passively live your life. You're only going to do what your fear tells you you're allowed to do without something dangerous happening. And that's why when we get down to the real core emotions inside of us, that's why we have this suppressed fear. We're suppressed in this fear generally, not really feeling our fear, not feeling our terror. So our suggestion is very different to that. Our suggestion is to actually feel the emotion you're talking about. So stop talking about it and forget about trying to share it with other people, and instead feel what you're talking about, and feel it inside of you. Feel what you feel, and that takes a bit of practice initially. Yeah. Can it maybe an illustration of yesterday? How you know how we were talking about your fear. What was your fear about?
It was about sex.
Oh yeah, we don't think.
We can go there, I don't mind. But some people are new, so they're right if we go into sex now. We were talking about I have a real fear of sharing my sexual self, the sexual part of who I am. I've had that fear this whole life. And now I have it still with me. So to really experience my sexual desire and to share that with AJ, it feels incredibly vulnerable to me. And I find that I come up to that fear and then I shut it down. I shut down sexually. So there's like a dance that happens. And I'm living in the fear. The fear is, if I expose this part of myself, he will laugh at it. He will ridicule what to me feels so intimate and personal. He will reject that. And so we're talking about the fact that I'm still living in that fear. I'm still in our sex life. I'm still, we're connecting and things are happening, but I'm still not fully just in the moment, fully in expression of my desire, because my fear is telling me if I do that, I'm completely vulnerable, and if he rejects me in that place, I'm crushed. I don't ever want to experience sexuality again.
Now that's the discussion.
Right. Yeah.
But I was saying to Mary, but we're not feeling the blockages here, right? So all I did was I grabbed Mary's arm, and all I did was stroke her arm like this. And then I said to her, feel what you feel about that. What do you feel? Right? Now, most people say they like being touched, right? Well, the truth is most people don't like being touched at all. For lots of reasons.
So yeah, this is probably what happened to get us to that realization.
Does
so
that make sense?
There was an issue that came up, and they just said, no, just feel what you actually feel. And I felt it, and I said, I don't want to be touched at all.
So Mary said that, she doesn't want to be touched. And then I said, well, that's okay to say I don't want to be touched, but obviously there's a reason why you don't want to be touched. So if I still stroke her arm, what's the reason why you don't want to be touched? Why won't you let this touch in to yourself? You know, feel it as a feeling that's loving.
So the feeling underneath that feeling was, I want to live alone. I want to live in a place where I have total control over everything, and I don't actually want a partner or anyone around me. I just want to have my own space.
Does that make sense? So but we're still not at the core emotion, aren't we? It's still
a layer.
There's still an angry space. Yeah. Still a layer. So. So what did you feel after that? So, but can I just point out first, Mary had to stop the process and go away and
I felt
feel the
yeah.
anger.
Yeah, which is pretty interesting in the Apollonia. I was like, in the
screaming into a pillow in a motel. Right? So
because I honestly didn't. The feelings took me by surprise. And I couldn't tell what was underneath them. Like, I couldn't figure it out.
And you don't have to tell what's underneath.
And
that's the point.
Where most people go wrong is try and figure it out. Or why would I want to be like, oh, because maybe... And in the end, your feelings will tell you if you just honour the top feeling. So that's what I had to go and do.
It's very important to understand that with the feelings, if you feel the top feeling, then what's underneath that feeling will become known to you. But if you don't feel the top feeling, what you'll be doing is you'll be confusedly trying to discover what the feeling is underneath. Does that make sense? So Mary, when I was doing this with Mary and she said, oh, I just don't want to be touched, right? That was the feeling, that was the top feeling. I said, well, no, instead of going any further than that, feel you don't want to be touched. Does that make sense? So Mary went into the room, we've fortunately got a bedroom there, it's not just a studio apartment, right? So Mary went in the bedroom, just went on the bed and screamed into the pillow and just felt the feeling that she does not want to be touched. Does that make sense? And then she came out maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes later.
So that took me into grief, and that the feeling under that was I want control. I want a controlled life and I want to be alone and separate. And so I had to cry and bash that one out a bit as well until I got to, and this is actually a bit of a different feeling than what we were talking about. The feeling was I feel out of control in our life. I feel there is no control at God, and I don't feel God will protect me, and I will lose AJ. So I cried about that one for quite a while.
Yeah.
And
so part of not wanting to have a relationship with me and not wanting to be touched by me was her fear of me dying, and then if she's open to me and I die, then there'll just be huge amounts of grief. Does that make sense? And so it's better to not start the relationship.
Yeah, we have that mentality a lot. Just not even bother.
Don't even bother.
Because
don't even go there.
If you lose that person, it's just so much.
Yeah, it's too hard. So Mary went through that grief as well in this process. But what I'm getting at there is the feeling of touch, the allowing yourself to actually concentrate on that emotion only, which is, I don't want to be touched. That's the feeling you need to feel, not talk about it. You don't need to talk about it at all. You can say, I don't want to be touched, and then just, you need to go into this feeling of not wanting to be touched. What's this feeling all about? But you can't leave it there, and this is what a lot of people do. They leave it there because they don't want to go deeper than that and find out what's underneath why they don't want to be touched. In other words, they don't want to ask the question, why? Why do I feel I don't want to be touched? Does that make sense?
And that's where you stagnate in progress. How can you progress? You can even go to the bedroom and bash the pillow, I don't want to be touched. But unless your heart wants to know what's underneath it, you won't find it.
You won't go further.
Can I ask, if you don't have a good connection in your progression at that time, I understand what you said. If you don't have a good connection with God, and you cannot connect to the feeling, what can you do? You can say pray.
Yeah, every time we cannot connect with a feeling, it's about fear. Fear is the thing that prevents us from connecting to feelings. So if we're struggling with connection to feeling, then the first thing to pray about is getting a desire to feel our fears. Most of us don't have a desire to feel our fears. We have a desire to avoid our fears. So we spend most of our life constructing a life that avoids fears, and you see this happening all the time, where people live in a relationship where they're not happy, for example, but they're too afraid to leave, because if they leave then they'll be alone, and they're too afraid to feel what it's going to feel like being alone, for example. So they'd rather live with someone they're not happy with than they would to feel the fear of being alone, for example. So what we finish up doing is we finish up constructing a life that is actually a fear-lived life. And many men in particular have a lot of difficulty acknowledging fear, even to themselves, because men are taught, we've got to be the strong one for the women. They're allowed to have a cry when they're afraid. But us guys, we're not allowed to have a cry when we're afraid. Yeah. We're not allowed to even say or admit that we're afraid. We've got to actually be strong and tough it all out. And so as guys, it's very, very hard to make the connection to fear. And to what else?
You said in a presentation last month that when there are women present, automatically women project its multi-generational fear because they want the male to protect them.
Yes.
And if I'm in front of Patra or Marina or someone else, and I want to cry, my feeling is to cry, I'm just asking, is it possible that without their knowing, their girl projects the fear?
Certainly, that is probably the case. In most cases, most women want their males for security in particular, and as a result of that, whenever the male goes into a very sort of a childlike crying state, then the woman becomes very afraid of, nobody's there around to protect her anymore.
So the practical way is to walk away and feel it by yourself.
Yes, and also this is where sometimes getting together as guys to discuss that, or as women to discuss things where you have codependent addictions. And what I mean by codependent addiction is where a man is projecting at a woman something, and then the woman's projecting at the man something, and while both of you are doing that, you're dependent on the other person remaining in their condition. So for example, while say Petra is fearful, and she's projecting on you, you've got to sort out my fears. You've got to make me feel safer. Protect me, particularly protect me from the other men who might hurt me. Protect me from them as well, but protect me in terms of protect my life. Some women have the projection at the male, you've got to look after me as well, which means that you're the one who's got to go out and get the money, and you've got to bring home the bacon, as the saying goes. And as a result of that, there's this codependent addiction. The male then becomes addicted to his role. So he becomes addicted to this role of being the provider, being the person who makes the woman feel safe. And so when the male needs to go through an emotion, he's already so hooked into the woman and her feelings that he's got to make her feel safe, that he won't even let himself feel his emotion.
Does that make sense? Do you see there's the trade-off? it's the emotions you get from the woman. You're a good man, like.
You're a good man, you make me feel safe and secure. Oh, you're wonderful, I love you so much.
But then there's the second thing.
And that's multi-generational.
Yes.
It is multi-generational,
yeah.
Yes.
The second thing is often men have a feeling, I'm a good man if a woman thinks I'm good.
Yeah.
So.
And only if a woman thinks I'm good.
If the woman, if I stop doing, if I start feeling an emotion, not only does Patra feel unsafe, and so I don't get nice emotions from her now, but also I feel I'm a bad man. So it's not only her, it's my feelings about me if
I'm not
making the woman.
But not a man anymore. I'm not masculine.
I lose my masculinity.
Yes.
And then as a result of that, most males have the habit then of shutting down any of their emotion and denying, in fact, that they have that feeling. Because if they admit they have it, then they've got to go through this whole process where the woman might be angry with them, the woman will say, well, you're a weak man now. And even if the woman doesn't say it, he might still feel it because of what he was brought up to feel from his own childhood. He might still
from
feel
his
it.
Own dad.
From his own dad.
Yeah.
And his own mum.
Yeah.
So the issue then is, from a male's perspective, is every single time you cannot connect emotionally to what's going on in your life, the first thing to look at is, what are your fears in relation to the emotions with the people around you, rather than your fears about dangerous things? See, many men don't have many fears about driving a car fast or doing something dangerous with their life, like climbing a cliff or something like that, climbing trees or all those kind of things. Many men don't have those kind of fears. In fact, we often enjoy those kind of things, but we have a lot of fears associated with, what will the women think of us? What does my woman think of me? Does she want me even? We have a lot of emotional fears that we often do not admit to. And as a result of that, we often then shut down our feelings quite strongly and therefore cannot feel our desires or our longing for God or any of those other things.
Sometimes while not wanting to feel some fear of mine, one of the reasons is, I feel that the woman will take advantage of that and feel that she wants to control me.
Yep.
when I'm humble and powerless.
Yep.
And I want to get away from that.
Yep.
Because it's really hard.
Yep.
And I cannot do anything to protect that.
Yeah. And that's a very common feeling for men and women, Nico, that the other gender will actually take advantage of them when they're in a vulnerable state. So that's why often we don't want to be vulnerable with our partner, because we feel that, they might take advantage of us in that state. We don't often want to be vulnerable with other people, because we feel that they'll take advantage of us.
But because most of the people really don't want to take advantage of us, but they are influenced by spirit.
Well, I don't know if most of the people don't want to take advantage of it, because the reality is that most of the time, we wouldn't have this emotion unless most people in our life in the past have taken advantage of us.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That emotion wouldn't even exist in us if there hadn't been some taking advantage of us in the past.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that in normal life, you just met a person, he doesn't really want to take advantage of you. That's not his first impression, but if you are humble, then I can see the spirits manipulating
you. Yeah, that's true.
And there is a war.
Can you see, Nico, though it's more, what you're talking about is more of a fear of vulnerability.
Yeah.
Can you see that?
Yeah.
So when a person is focused on, others will take advantage of me, the issue is whether they will or not. The issue is, how am I going to respond to them taking advantage of me? That's the real issue. And that's a fear of your own vulnerability. It's a fear of being attacked, basically. A fear of being manipulated when you're open.
Because can you feel, in the way that you're describing it, you're living in the fear.
Yeah,
you feel that this is going to happen. Instead of feeling, challenging the fear and challenging it with truth, that even if it does happen, I will still feel my feelings and be vulnerable. The problem with a lot of fear is we say, well, it could happen, it will happen, it's possible. Like, there are horrible people in the world, and this guy's saying
it's
Jesus, they're going to kill him, This is all my living in the fear. It's a possible probable thing. The liberating thing is to say, okay, even if that does happen, I will still love and I will still feel myself, even if it does happen. Do you see the difference? One is about being courageous in your emotional state, and the other is about saying, well, that would be horrible if it happened, so I'm not going to have that horrible event. And so that's when I start living in the...
I'm going to try and prevent that horrible event. The reality is, the irony is, your law of attraction will not prevent the horrible event.
I know that.
As you well know, yeah, from your own life, right? So your fear of vulnerability has not helped you in your relationships. Can you see? What it's done, in fact, has hindered the relationship, because you then become suspicious of vulnerability. Right? You're worried that other people will take advantage of your vulnerability.
But they do take advantage when I try to.
But can you say,
they're definitely going to.
They're going to do that, and the way to be liberated from the fear is to feel that.
But another reason why they're taking it, they do definitely, is because you have this emotion in you that they will. You see, this we're often putting like the cart before the horse with our statements. You know, we go like. Perhaps the best thing I can do is give an illustration about the law of attraction. Law of attraction is really such that my soul creates people doing things to me, not the other way around. Do you understand? You see? I love it when we go. It's got that deep groan of it.
It's like, you know, I had a different perception.
Yes, what you have the perception of is the flip side of that. You're saying that people will come to you and then...
I will attract them because they feel this way, but I didn't...
You're attracting them because you feel this way, not them. They are coming to you because you feel this way. Does that make sense?
And that's why if you experience the emotion, it's no longer in you, and you're free.
I'm vulnerable, Nico, about my entire life, right? And even though it might look like I get attacked a lot, the reality is in my life I don't get attacked a lot, even though I'm vulnerable about my entire life. So, and I don't have a belief that people have to attack me just because I'm vulnerable. I don't have that fear in me that that's going to be created. So the reality is, we've got to first understand with regards to the law of attraction that the emotion is in me, and that's what's attracting this event to me. The emotion begins with me, not with the other person. The other person certainly has their problems and their particular issues and so forth. The fact that a person wants to take advantage of vulnerability, for example, is definitely an error in their own soul. I agree. However, if I focus on their error in their soul, I forget that the creator is the error in my own soul. You see? And unfortunately, this is what many people are doing on the so-called divine love path. They point the finger and they go, oh, that person's got this problem, and you've got this problem, and you've got this problem, and you've got this problem. Not going, well, yeah, now I'm sitting in the room with a person with that problem, and this problem. Why am I sitting in this room with these people? Obviously, I have something in my soul that's attracted a person with this problem, attracted a person with that problem. Do you see? And the only person I can change is
me.
I can't change them. I can complain as much as I like.
Well, tell them what their problem is.
I can complain to Mary as much as I like. Babe, you do this all the time, and you do that all the time, you do this all the time. I can complain as much as I like. I have no hope of changing me.
I want to continue in that particular area.
Can I just, before we do though, do you understand that, Nico? Like, do you understand that the moment that I take away the focus from what is inside of my soul, I am now completely removing.
Loud and clear. I don't like it though.
I am completely removing the power of my own to change.
May I say something? But in the first century, you were at one with God, you were at one moment, but they still killed you. And this.
Yeah, but I didn't feel bad about it.
Right.
Why?
But
that's what I don't understand. No, that's my question.
No, what I mean is that, like, so if your soul is attracting this, yes, but your soul is.
Well, see, when you become at one with God,
yeah,
your soul is going to attract some pretty intense events. The reason why is because you are going to be in a state of complete truth,
mm-hmm,
and complete love,
mm-hmm,
and complete love of yourself. Now, in that state, surrounding you is what?
Error.
There's all these people in complete error, totally unloving. When they look at you, what are they going to feel? They're going to feel terrible about themselves, they're going to feel jealous, they're going to feel all sorts of feelings, angry, aren't they? Who are they going to focus that on?
You.
Yeah. Now, if I'm focused on what they feel about me, do you think I'm ever going to be happy?
Of course not.
Never. Let me answer your question, because I know the question you're going to ask. You can be completely happy in that state, even though you're getting these attacks and so forth, because you have this perfect connection with God where you now feel that everything that's happening around you is no longer your fault. You don't feel that everything that is being projected at you has anything to do with you, because it no longer does anymore, because you've released any emotion that would cause any of those attractions. Does that make sense? Based on your emotional error. So you know you're no longer in error. You have a permanent connection with God. You know you're no longer in error. You know you are perfect, actually, now. Now, if you knew you were perfect, I mean really knew, and really felt it in your heart, then not from some arrogant position, but because you're in this abundant connection with God, and you know you're perfect, would you ever feel sad about what anybody chooses to do around you?
Is there any different action we would take if we understand and realize that we are not doing the right thing in this emotional interaction? Is there any different action, practical action we can take, except from releasing the emotion?
Well, the problem with taking the action without releasing the emotion is you're not now learning anything from what was just attracted to you. So what you're doing is you're now setting up the next action that's going to be the same. Because your law of attraction won't change. The only time your attraction will change is when your soul changes. So once your soul changes to a complete degree and now you're one with God, you are completely happy with yourself, and you're completely happy with everyone else. It doesn't matter then what they do anymore.
Another aspect. I mean, I really connected with your...
Nico, you didn't hear that one.
No, I didn't.
No. So just stop for a moment.
Okay.
And let yourself hear that. You see, you do not have a belief, you do not have a faith that when you're at one with God, that it won't matter what other people do.
No.
You don't have that faith.
No, I don't.
So pray about that.
And the truth is, Nico, in the example I was giving you earlier, even if you process this emotion that you have, that when I'm vulnerable, people will take advantage of me, even if you process that one emotion, you would be able, and the hurt you feel about people taking advantage of you, then you would be vulnerable with people, whether they took advantage of that or not. So you're not even at one with God yet, but you still don't worry about that, how other people feel about you in that one aspect in your life.
Can I give you an example? Myself and Mary had a news, a TV team come and visit us. They stayed in our house for 2 days, right? They took nearly 50 hours of video of us. They presented on television a less than 5 minute show, of which 30 seconds was us actually speaking. After living in our house for 2 days, and we fed them and everything, like, so we were completely open and vulnerable. Does that make sense? Now, I had no fear about that, what they were going to do about that. Even knowing in advance that they were probably going to misuse that information.
Why did you do it?
Because love gives people opportunities.
I give them the chance of doing the right thing.
Because love would do that for everyone.
I can give love.
And in giving them the opportunity, now they took an opportunity, they used it in a sort of an evil way,
yeah.
Right? In fact, in Australia, that was the worst television show about us, and that was presented. It's the same people, Channel 7 it was. Now they took that opportunity. Would I give them another opportunity? If I love them.
If you love yourself.
And them.
And them.
Firstly, you have to go with yourself.
Firstly?
I mean, if you love yourself, you will not permit somebody to project that.
Yeah, see, I don't feel love of... I don't feel love is distinguishable between love of myself and love of another.
If you love the others, then you would give them again and again and again the chance until they learn.
No.
You
why?
If you think about it, love in its purest form is loving to you and me at the same time.
Yes.
So that would dictate if I...
If I break the law from the one side, there is no point of doing it.
And what happens if I give you an opportunity to love and you don't take that opportunity and nothing changes within you, why would I give you another opportunity? Because what would you learn from this opportunity?
Yeah, see, I don't feel the same as Mary on that subject. I feel you would give them another opportunity.
But, you know, if nothing changes in Nico?
I would still give people another opportunity.
I have both emotions in me. Sometimes when I ask what's the most loving thing to do, I most of the times react like you do, Rich. You know, because one of my major things is that one. You know, I always give love to everybody else.
But not to yourself.
But not to myself.
Can I say though, Nico, it's not for me, it's not so much about the love of you or the love of me. It's more about the love of truth to me. So when I say love of truth, what I mean is the love of what's the absolute truth. So for example, in this interaction I had with Channel 7, the absolute truth is that they took all of this truthful footage of us over a period of a fair few weeks, and they stayed with us for a couple of days, and all these different things. And then the very first part of the opening words of their show was, our secret hidden cameras recorded these events. Now, these were secret hidden cameras that we actually have photographs on the internet. Well, where, you know, there's photographs of them taking the shots, right, with their secret hidden cameras. Now in that moment, they lied.
Yeah.
Agreed?
Yeah.
Right, and we have evidential proof that they lied. Right, so what would love do now? Now, it's not about so much whether I love myself or even love you. It's about whether I love the truth or not. If I love the truth, what would I do?
Share the picture.
I would create a way in which the person can address this untruth. Do you follow me? So the man rings up again and says, oh, we'd like to do some more interviews. What am I going to say to him? I say, well, David, look, the last interviews you did, you lied. Now, I'm perfectly happy to do another interview. In other words, I'm perfectly happy to give you another opportunity to tell the truth. However, I'm not going to give you that opportunity until you tell the truth about the previous opportunity I gave you. Does that make sense?
That's
so, but that's different from allowing opportunities to, like, to me, you always have an opportunity to love, no matter how anybody treats you. But it's, for me, it's loving to say that to him. Do you follow me?
Yes.
I'm not being unloving saying that to him. I'm actually loving him saying that to him, because I'm trying to help him understand that he lied and it's damaged his soul and he can correct it. He can do something to undo the damage to his soul. Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally.
I'm not making the choice, oh, he didn't love me, so I am not, I'm, you know, that's it now. I'm not saying it for that reason. I'm saying it because I love the truth, and I want to give this man, who sure didn't love me, but I want to give this man an opportunity to work his way through this issue still, even though he didn't love me the first time. Does that make sense?
But in that, you don't operate in the same condition again. You do the loving thing. That's the most loving thing. Just saying, yep, come and stay for another 2 days, that's unloving to them and to us.
Yeah.
Because they're not having
the opportunity. But the question was whether I would give the person opportunity to love every time, and the answer is yes.
Yes, I see. That is an opportunity.
The answer is every single time I will give them another opportunity to love.
Like God.
Exactly. Yes. Like if we want to become at one with God, we're eventually going to have to do things the way God does them. That God gives us constant opportunities. Like how many times have you done the wrong thing on the same issue over and over and over and over again? How many times have you yelled at your child, for example, over and over and over again? And yet God's constantly giving you the opportunity to not do that by dealing with different things and trying to help you through that process. You see, if I'm not emotionally involved in this aspect of truth, then I am clear to be able to love everybody and love the truth at the same time. The instant that I now have an emotional involvement, so in other words, I feel hurt that Channel 7 lied about me, now I am not going to be loving if I say, no, I don't want you to come to my home. I'm saying the same thing, that I'm not coming to my home, but I'm saying it because I feel hurt. That's not a position of love anymore. Can you see? Whereas the first position of love, which was saying, no, I would like you to come to my home, but the last time you come to my home, you told lies. So what I would like you to do first is to untell all of those lies, and then I'm very, very happy for you to come to my home. Now that's a position of truth, and that's also a position of love. Does that make sense? One is a rejection of the person because of my own hurt. The other is saying to the person, no, I'm going to give you another opportunity to demonstrate that you can love. That's the difference.
And can you see how, Panos, I think you asked about taking an action?
Yeah, different action.
Yeah.
In the example of Nikos, just the introduction in his life in order to help him release the emotion or see something different.
Well, I feel that a different action is very positive, like particularly if you're living in fear. So if your fear is dictating your actions, my suggestion is every single time take a different action. Does that make sense? Like, so if today you go shopping because for the same reason that it's Thursday and that's when you've got money in the bank, my suggestion is go shopping when you haven't. Do something completely different that will challenge the emotion or the fear that is in you, in other words. Right? And you can certainly do that, but in the end you need to still feel the emotion. Because if you don't feel the emotion, nothing will change.
And I was going to say, if you take the action with the sense of punishment or prevention of the thing,
you're hurting the other person.
Well, you're hurting you.
Hurting yourself as well.
I double hurt myself.
Yeah.
I've done it.
Yeah.
I've seen the effects.
Yeah. Igor?
With the love of truth question, in the first century you being at one with God, would your allowing the crucifixion, would it be because of love of truth for you? Because you could have prevented it?
I could have taken an action that temporarily prevented it, is probably the best way. So for example, what I could have done is I could have left Jerusalem and gone to a place where the people who had been trying to kill me for some time couldn't find me, and then I would have prevented my own death temporarily. And I could have taken that action without any fear involved. I could just take the action because I wanted to live a bit longer and choose to do that. However, to take that action, I would have had to also stop some of my passions. one of my passions was to teach the truth. Now, to leave, I would have had to make sure nobody knew who I, where I was. I would have to, you know, we would have to be live a private life where myself and Mary lived our little private life, but not very many people knew where we lived and all of those kind of things. And that wasn't my passion. My passion was to live a normal, passionate life, teaching the divine truth to people. That was my passion. And so it got to a point in the first century where I had to have a make a personal choice between our passions, my passion for truth, and my life. Does that make sense? Yep. Teaching the truth in my life. I had to make a choice. Was I going to continue to teach the truth and do it in a passionate way with the risk of my death being much higher, or was I going to go off into some wilderness, you know, and become a very private recluse and only have particular people who were in the know come and visit me, right? And in the end, would that happen for very long anyway? So after a while, they'd tell other people, and eventually everyone would know where you were anyway, right? So I could temporarily make the choice to prolong my life, but only by sacrificing my love of myself. Does that make sense? And my love of God and my love of truth. So I got to a point where I didn't feel any longer that I could sacrifice my love of God and my love of truth and my love of myself and for the sake of prolonging my life. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question about prayer, connecting to what you asked, and that is, how do I pray when I can't connect to God and I can't feel the longing? What is left is like me being kind of a slight plastic. It's like, so it's just words.
So you feel numb?
Yes.
Yep.
So I just pray words to just get myself started. But
yeah, and it doesn't work.
Yeah, but it may take some time, and maybe you have a better way to...
Yeah, like my feeling is that if you're praying words without feelings and it feels all plastic, then it is.
Yeah,
and
so I say
pointless doing it.
Well, I usually say, God, now I feel very plastic.
Yeah, that's better.
Yeah,
because that's actually stating a truth.
Yeah.
So, God, I feel very plastic is a truth, or God, I feel like I'm detuned and I'm numb, you know?
Yeah.
That's a truth. So that is better.
Yeah.
That's more of a prayer.
When I find myself numb, Eva, I usually try to take myself back to the fear that I've avoided. Because it's inevitably a fear that's come up that I've avoided that has made me go out of my body, allow spirits to sort of, you know, push me into this non-feeling, non-everything. Numb, just sort of, can't feel myself, can't feel anything, So I usually try to go back to what inevitably there is one, a fear that was triggered that I didn't feel or that I suppressed.
So can I give you an example perhaps again?
Yeah.
You might feel pretty open when you're home by yourself towards God, right? But as soon as your husband walks in the door, you go numb. So what you would need to do there is go, okay, I'm now numb in my connection to God. Now I can start saying, God, I'm numb. Well, that's true, but where does that get me? And there's an acknowledgement at least that I'm numb, and that I'm now plastic, if you like, in your words. But it doesn't find the reason why, does it, at all? It doesn't help me discover the reason why. So what I would have to start doing is having a desire to go back to when I felt that feeling first of numbness, the feeling that I'm detuned from everything. When did that begin? So I start longing, and remember, prayer is your longing. So if I start longing to find out when did that begin, it's very rapidly, generally, I'll find that out. And it happened when my husband walked in the door. Okay, so then you start allowing yourself to feel, and you can engage God in this process by asking God to help you to remember what your feeling was at the time he walked in the door.
Fear. I'm so fearful of him.
So he walks in the door and you're afraid. But what are you afraid of?
to his expectations or disappointment, that I don't
do what he
I'm
wants
not happy any. Enough or something like that.
Right. So
loving enough.
Yep. So can you start, you're starting to now feel that, right, I can feel that this is a fear, and I can feel that this is, I'm afraid of his expectation and demand. But why am I afraid of his expectation and demand? What do I feel? Just so you go back to the event of him walking in the door, and instead of intellectualizing the event, you go into your feeling, you go, what was the feeling I was avoiding in that moment when he walked in the door? Oh, the feeling was panic. I was panicked. As soon as he walked in the door, I just felt, what do I got to do now for him? What do I got to do to cheer him? What do I got to... That's the feeling I have right at that moment. And can you see, as you let yourself feel that feeling, you might start even processing something right then and there, right, with regard to just feeling that feeling. And you'll no longer be numb. You'll no longer be plastic in that moment, you see. But what we often do is the opposite to this. He walks in the door, the feeling rises in us, and we don't like feeling it. So what we do is we suppress it. In suppressing it, we've now suppressed all of our emotions. And this is a basic thing we need to come to understand about truth, about our emotional state, and that is, every time I attempt to suppress one single emotion inside of me, I will automatically suppress all other emotions inside of me. In other words, the suppression of emotion is not selective.
No,
we think it's selective. No. We hope it's selective.
Yeah.
But it isn't selective.
No.
Right?
Yes.
The instant that you suppress your fear, at the same time you must, because of the suppression that's required to suppress fear, you will also find you suppress emotion, you suppress desire, passion, joy, you suppress everything, right? Mm. And what we've got to do is go back to the moment in time when that began. And if it began when my husband walked in the door, then I know what the trigger is to that suppression. Does that make sense?
Then I know why I get a headache every Friday, Saturday. Especially when he's been on a business trip. I know it had to do with him.
Yeah.
Or with me.
It never has to do with him.
No,
it has to do
me.
With you,
yes.
And your feelings about him.
About men, perhaps.
And of your
my
feelings
dad.
About your dad. Yeah,
yeah,
of course. So be careful about going, well, yeah, he walks in the door and I feel this, so therefore it's his fault.
No.
This is where we're not, you know, the only person we can change is ourselves. He can walk in the door with those same emotions later on, and you'll go, I'm fine. I still feel connected to my emotions, I still feel connected to my desires and passions. The fact that he's walking in the door and you're no longer feeling connected is an indication that there's something to heal inside of yourself. Not him necessarily. What was your name again?
Dionysus.
Yes. Okay. Is that short for John?
What?
Short for
no,
John.
That's short for Dionysus.
Like the god of wine. Yeah,
we were just talking about Dionysus this morning.
Do you know much about his history? The god of which you're named after?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Okay. It was like a big god, not only for the wine and stuff.
Yeah.
Light.
Yeah. Actually, you know, in my first century life, you know the thing that they said that I turned water into wine? I didn't do that.
I didn't do that.
But Dionysus might have.
But it was to try to compare me to Dionysus.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Also, Dionysus, the same story with the disciples and stuff.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like Mithra.
Yeah. Far away, my friend.
Yeah. You said about that if we release our fears, then our passions and desires will pop up. And what if we keep on releasing our fears and some other passions and desires pop up? Are they added to the previous ones, or the previous ones were, you know, more facade?
With passions and desires, my suggestion is to not judge them very much, mm-hmm. and just to follow them as long as they're harmonious with love. They will change in your life, for sure.
Because I'm you know, I'm not driving events that change now my passions and my desires. I thought they were okay.
Yeah.
And now I think they constantly are changing.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's right, because, you know, some of them are very conforming, and some others I think that I can still do that, but I feel like this attracts me, you know, far more better, but yeah. I judge it.
Yeah, the key is to not judge your passions and desires, to only act upon them when they're loving. So in other words, many of us have passions and desires that are unloving, as well as passions and desires that are loving. Now, the passions and desires that are unloving, the best way to deal with them is to acknowledge that they are there and to feel them, and then to try to discover the reasons why you have them. So, for example, for a male, it seems to me like, I'll make a comment about a Greek male, because we went down the beach yesterday, and man, the sexual projections coming from the Greek males were pretty intense, as well as from the females, mind you, too. But so here I am, I'm a male, and I'm down the beach, and I'm looking at all these scantily clad women in bikinis, and projecting at them that I want to have sex with every one of them, right? Now, that's a desire. Is it very harmonious with love? No, but it is a desire. So what you need to do is you need to acknowledge it, that it's there present, and you want to discover more about it. You want to discover why you have it. Because if you don't discover why you have it, you're never going to release it. You're never going to release it from you. Does that make sense? So let yourself feel the desire and let yourself feel why you have it. Now, many of the men who were down the beach doing this yesterday, if they felt their desire properly and they acknowledged it to themselves rather than sort of just wanting to have sex with a woman, and they acknowledged they wanted to do that, and then they went deeper into it, they'd realize that they're actually quite sad. They actually feel like they don't really have a good connection with women generally, and they actually have quite a lot of sadness about that to feel. That's what they'd eventually feel if they let themselves feel further down the tune of that desire. But what we do with our desires that are negative generally is we either judge them as, oh, that's evil, and so we don't want to think about it at all.
We deny it.
Or we try to embrace it as a in rebellion. So in other words, I'm allowed to, you know, feel like I can project at every single woman sexually. So this is what many men do, right? So they feel, I'm allowed to, I'm a male. And then we justify that by going, that's how men are made, you know? Like, you look at the animal kingdom. In other words, now we're comparing men with animals. But nevertheless, we continue down that reasoning. And we allow ourselves to justify it that way. So we either do it by going into rebellion, or we go into denial completely and say, no, I don't feel that. What I suggest to do instead is to not deny, to feel the evil or negative emotion, the negative passion or desire, feel it, and then allow yourself to explore it more. Allow yourself to explore it in an effort to discover what its cause is. Does that make sense? Now, I don't mean by being unloving in exploring it. So in other words, I wouldn't act upon it. I would actually explore it and go inside of myself and go, I obviously is still like, you know, I'm looking at all these women and I'm looking at their bottoms all hanging out of their bikinis and I'm going, well, that's very true, isn't it, David? And I'm going, you know, yeah, you know, I'm looking at them and feeling these sexual things as a result. And so obviously there's something going on here, because that's detuning me from having a longing just for my soulmate. And that's detuning my sexual, it's actually spreading my sexual energy. Instead of my sexual energy now being focused on my soulmate, one person, my sexual energy is now being spread across 10, 15, 20 people, maybe.
And it's losing its value, it's losing its
losing
strength.
Its value and strength, but its preciousness, its purity and its love, right? It's all losing all that in the process. And I'm discovering this about myself, and I'm feeling, okay, I can go deeper into that emotionally and feel like, why am I doing this? And then I can start connecting to some pretty raw emotion if I decide to. Raw emotion about sadness with women, about how I feel no woman really wants me. You know, if a woman really wants me sexually, I feel like I'm validated as a male. I feel like I'm a good male only when the woman wants me sexually. And I feel like I'm attractive then, but if no woman wants me, I don't feel attractive. And so forth. There could be lots of emotions involved in that, right? So that's my passions and desires in it that I won't act upon, but I'll still let myself feel. But when I notice I have a passion and desire that is loving, I don't see, and by the way, that might change too. My analysis of whether it's loving a lot might change as I progress. But I look at it and I go, no, I can't see anything wrong with this passion and desire. My suggestion in that case is to follow it with passion and desire.
Until it changes, if it changes.
And it may change, but it may not. You will find generally what happens is it gets refined rather than it being dropped off completely, you refine it in purity.
I've tried to live like that for the past month, and I've discovered that many things have changed and either been refined or rejected from me, or, you know.
That's it?
That's the beautiful thing about living passionately, is the law of attraction is heightened by desire. When I'm really passionate, I attract more things that will refine it. So the law of, if I'm willing to notice my law of attraction, my passions and desires become more and more pure.
I've attracted the girl. I thought maybe she was some kind of soulmate. But you know, now I'm thinking that thought or passion or desire I had for her, maybe it's been provoked by some new things that came up.
Yep. And that's wonderful. Follow the passion and desire until you no longer feel it's loving. Then look at it very strongly then. So, because once we no longer feel it's loving, then obviously it was based on an addiction of some kind, trying to get something met. And we want to look at our addictions. We want to find
my life is an addiction. I realized that, you know, and I'm trying to get rid of these addictions, but, you know, addictions are very powerful in my life at this point.
Well, the fact is that for the majority of people on Earth, addictions are the primary motivator for their entire life. That's the fact. And to get out of that condition takes a lot of effort. But following your passions is the way to get out of that addiction.
Yes, well, that's what we can do.
Yeah. So can I illustrate, you know, when you wanted to do the workshops, I think that's a good illustration of that. Like, initially...
Yeah. Could I illustrate?
Yeah.
So I wanted to do these workshops for people last year, and some of you did them who are here.
Why did you want to do them?
I wanted to do them... Really, I wanted to do them because I felt like, and I still have this feeling that I'm working through, I have no voice, I have no purpose, I have no value. You have Jesus, you don't really need me, you know, and I want a role. I don't have a role, and my passions and desires are the same as his, but I feel he expresses them much more perfectly than I do. So I feel like I've felt like, and I still do a lot, that there's nothing... I can't offer anything. So I wanted to, and I also saw a lot of people talking about emotions and not feeling. So there was a little bit of purity in there. I felt passionate about teaching and wanting to create something that would help people maybe stop talking and start feeling a little bit and be challenged in a way that I had been challenged in our day-to-day life. Like, no, now you're not fit. Now you're, you know, living with Jesus, that happens. You're given truth constantly. So I decided I would create these workshops. And I stepped into doing the workshops and did the first one, and it went okay. People seemed to feel some emotions, and all of my big ideas seemed to translate into something. And then I did the second one. And the second one, it didn't feel very good. I came home and I said, yeah, just felt off. And people were really grateful, but in quite a, it didn't feel authentic either. It was like I'd met some addictions. So I came home and I talked to AJ about that, and I said, I feel like there's something there for me, like I've attracted this. And I realized I had a huge addiction to people liking me. So because I wanted everyone to like me and think I was this great
person who said something. I saw that presentation on YouTube and I just saw the first 3 minutes and I turned it off. I said, no. I prefer to read your blog rather than watching that video.
Yeah.
But after I saw you the last month, you were around Australia and you were talking with AJ.
Yeah.
You were great. You were like yourself. The first one was over.
Many of them have been awful, and I still watch the ones that now, and I feel awful about them. Yeah, anyway, what happened is my desire was refined. By the last workshop, I no longer wanted to do workshops because I felt that they're actually distracting me from the pure connection with my soulmate. But in the process, the point of the story is, in the process, many of my emotions were refined. In my desire for approval, I didn't deal with all of that, but I certainly dealt with a huge amount. My willingness to admit my faults to others, I have a lot of fear about humiliation, but I realised I was living in that fear rather than confronting it by admitting that I have error and that I'm not pure and I didn't do well or I made a mistake here. I worked through that a lot. So now I feel in a much more pure space about teaching, although I still am processing through the emotion that I don't have anything to offer. And my law of attraction brings me beautiful opportunities to do that.
Just like the one.
Just happens.
Yes.
Yeah. Right, so listening.
Yeah. I don't know if you noticed, but when you made that comment about Mary and the start of, actually the majority of the audience just stopped listening to Mary. And this is a part of the law of attraction for Mary, in the sense that she feels she doesn't have sort of like that role thing. And
I feel that by exposing error, it makes me less valuable.
Yes, but it's Yeshua and Yeshua. You know, the other female part.
Can I ask something? Can I ask a question?
No, what do you feel there?
I just feel that emotion.
What are you feeling from the innocent?
That I don't have anything to offer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, but
I think you're allowed to feel that.
I think you do. Because... okay,
you say what you're feeling.
Yeah. The feeling I have is that that you like me, but you don't feel I have anything to offer for the teaching. And that's okay. That's a feeling that I need to process anyway. Yeah.
But it is a feeling that's projected at Mary quite frequently. Like there's a lot of statements of Mary being the other half of myself, without very much understanding of what that actually means, and very little understanding that Mary and my soul is the same soul. There's one soul, not two. And as a result, it's just a matter of how we go channeling it, or how we go expressing our soul, as to how clear it becomes. Now, but you're feeling a bit of anger too.
Am I?
Yeah, you were when everyone started talking. So the key is to...
I felt, yeah, okay, yep.
Can you feel that?
No. The feeling. Now I feel everyone not listening. And just keeping talking.
Because you know that rigid place you go to when everyone doesn't listen? Yeah. Yeah. So what happens for Mary is she feels everyone not listening, and then it's like, oh, well, it's pointless me saying anything now. Mm. You know what I mean? There's that rigidity that comes over her, which comes over many of you when you're in your personal private relationships, right? You know that your husband's not listening or your wife's not listening anymore, so what's the... You know,
what's the point?
F this is what we often do, isn't it?
Like,
what's the point of opening our mouths now?
That's how I feel. What is actually the point? And the point is, it's only...
The point is to feel that emotion in that moment. That's the thing. That's where the law of attraction is bringing you this event, to feel this emotion in that moment. And when you shut down and when you get rigid, you're not feeling that emotion in that moment anymore.
Yeah, and I suppose the difference is I would have hit that, what's the point, and just sat in that now for the next hour. I hit it. I didn't even notice myself hit it. You did. But then
but
I just started feeling...
What would happen in the past for Mary is that she would have shut down completely, wouldn't you? Pretty much. You would have gone silent.
Yeah. I just would have thought, there's no point talking because he can do it better and I don't have anything to say, offer, or whatever the thing is. What's the point of speaking? And there are many talks where I've sat in that for 2 hours.
I had an emotion in me, you know, just when Dionysus
told you you are Yeshua's half. Yeah, but I don't like it. I don't like it because he is your half also, and people try to focus, you know, to one half and they forget the other.
Exactly.
And it's so beautiful.
And it's actually, Mary and I were talking about this yesterday, how Mary still has this viewpoint that she is my other half.
Like I said it to him, I'm the other half of your soul. Yeah. And then I went away and I went, do you realise what I just said to you?
Yeah. Whose soul?
Yeah.
I'm the other half of her soul.
Yeah. Oh.
But very few people see it that way. And why won't they see it that way, do you think?
They try to prefer the other one because she's more powerful or whatever, more beautiful.
Can I tell you one of the major reasons? Inside my soul, I feel I don't have anything to offer. That's the predominant reason why most people don't feel I have anything to offer. There is another there's other reasons as well.
There's historical and also obviously, you know, worldwide based reasons about males and females.
And there's also AJ's more developed in love right now. So the delivery of answers and truth comes in a more fluid way, and people, they want that for themselves, so they gravitate that way. But the predominant reason is just my own condition.
And I don't like the idea, you know, both times AJ be the more developed guy in the relationship.
For now.
It's interesting you don't like it, Nico. What?
No, no, the thing is, hey man, I want my chance too, you know? I feel less immediately from that.
Yeah.
Why, in the first century, I mean, why did God choose AJ based on his laws and not me also, you know? I may feel a little bit injustice there. I'm not worthy of it.
Do you feel like for Mary too, it feels unfair for Mary?
Yeah.
Can you see, Nico, that this is also what you feel in relation to many women, and this is why you pander to them? Can you see it? Can you see
use a different word for pandering.
Pandering to them, meaning you look after them and do what they want.
Yes.
And it's because that you feel that the women have had an unfair life. There's a big feeling inside of you from your childhood that women have had an unfair life, and so now as a male you feel your role is to make their life more fair. But in the process of doing that, you finish up pandering to them or doing things for them that they could do for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And also you're not respecting the fact that actually Mary needs to feel this emotion. You see? As she has told you just now, actually, without you hearing, she needs to feel this emotion. And once she gets through that emotion, everyone around us will actually feel that our relationship is a lot more balanced or even. Does that make sense?
Their relationship to us, you mean?
No. Everyone around us will feel that our relationship is more balanced or even once Mary feels our relationship is balanced and even.
Mm.
Does that make sense? Mm. The power of our soul is that we create a lot of people's impression of our soul.
Mm.
And this is getting back to the original question you asked, which was, you know, the need for us to see the law of attraction as not something external, but rather
internal.
So it's very, very, initially when Mary felt this emotion, she saw it as external. Why does everybody treat me that way? Why, you know, like blaming externally what's going on. And then when she started feeling about it more, she realized, oh, this is a feeling I have about myself, which is what is being reflected at me by other people. Does that make sense? And this is what you are avoiding doing in your own life. You're avoiding seeing it, what's coming at you as your creation, beliefs you have within your soul. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is why you feel connected with Mary. Does that mean?
Do you feel connected with Mary just on this issue?
Well, he feels, what's the best word, like a compassion Well, it's not really. It's not really sympathy. Well, it's not really sympathy in a pure way either.
It's a commiseration.
It's more of a commiseration. Yeah. Yes, and protection of the woman. Like you want to protect Mary from her emotion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which is an addiction.
Which is an addiction in Nico. Yeah, to protect the woman from her own bad feelings.
It also, it's part of my manhood as I learned it.
That's what a man does. Yeah. The reality is that God, you notice God never does it? God never protects you from your own emotion. Have you noticed that? You're forced to confront every one of your own emotions by God. So if God never does it, then it's not pure masculinity to do it. Just like if from a female perspective, you know, there's a lot of things we do that women do as well. But if God never does it, then it's not pure femininity. Because God is purely masculine and purely feminine in the sense of pure, in terms of the pure, in terms of love, pure. And so anything God doesn't do that we do is actually impure. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So let's say a group of women get together and they talk about their husbands. Right? And they talk and talk, but nobody actually feels any emotion. They just talk about it. Then that's something that many women do. But is that pure? Is that pure femininity? See, a lot of people say, yeah, that's what women do. But actually, that's not what women in the celestial kingdom do. Right? It's only what women on earth do. And it's not pure femininity. It's what we've attributed as feminine, but it's actually not feminine. Does that make sense?
Yes, cool.
Yeah. Mary wants to give a long talk about femininity and...
definitely.
Because it's a major issue.
And sex.
And sexuality, that's what I was going to say, Katarina. Yeah. Yeah.
Please, we would like that.
Yeah. There's a lot that I want to say about sexuality, the way it's expressed, especially amongst women on the planet at the moment. I just feel it. It's a lot of shame that women are either rebelling against or living in.
And there's a lot of rebellion you were feeling, weren't there? Like you feel there's a lot of women are living in this sort of angry, rebellious place.
Against. Feeling shame, like, you know, this whole I'm claiming my sexuality. It feels
I'm
so
claiming my sluttiness, you know, like
this, the culture now to really and even if you look at recent movies, like there's all these women who are acting like men, and I don't feel they're you know, in a pure masculine state either, but this I don't care about sex, I only care about sex and I don't care about emotional connection. And there's a lot of movies depicting these women as really attractive women now, and there's also a lot of culture, popular culture, depicting women supposedly sexually confident, but they're actually flaunting their sexuality and sexually. To me, it feels like a huge rebellion against the same shame that kept everyone shut down before. And there's a lot of messages being given to women that to be promiscuous is actually to be powerful, and I feel it's very damaging. Yeah.
It's more damaging than the self-doubt, I feel.
Well, in a way.
In a way,
us also. Yeah, we can damage
other
partners. Yeah, I agree with that.
Whereas when you shut yourself down, the main person you're damaging is yourself. Yeah.
And your partner.
And
if
your
soulmate.
If
I'm in denial of my own sexuality, how can I? That's.
You'll never connect with your soulmate in that place. So that's a whole day on its own.
Yeah.
That discussion.
That'd be good.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask something. There's a lot of talking about fear from the beginning of this talking, and I'm really interested to it. I just wanted to ask something. How everybody has fears, right? I do. So how do you protect, in a way, ourselves, your soulmate, or your child, or the people you love, from giving the fish to them in the everyday interaction that you have with them, you know? Because it's something yours, you want to keep it to yourself and not, you know, put it into your husband, your wife.
Yeah.
And when you do that, there is another interaction and the other one interacts in a way and then you feel guilty and you ask for forgiveness and blah, 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 blah.
There's a whole series of actions,
a whole
chain of events.
Afterwards.
Yeah.
So how do you manage to keep it to yourself, keep the balance, keep the borders and deal with it?
Well, it's very
really
simple.
Your own fear.
Yeah, it's very simple. The first step is to acknowledge it inside of yourself, even if it's intellectually acknowledge it. The first
the
step,
fear.
The fear, I mean. So firstly, acknowledge your own fears. Every fear you do not acknowledge is automatically dumped on somebody else. Automatically. You will definitely dump it on somebody else if you do not acknowledge it within yourself. And the feeling comes out of you automatically. So let's example. Let's say I am afraid of relationships with women. I'm a male and I'm afraid of relationships with women. If I do not feel that fear, every single action I take and every single word I speak and every single decision I make in my life in relation to women is going to be acted upon that fear.
Through the filter?
Of that fear.
From my soul to the universe.
To the universe. So that means that it's unavoidable that all my entire universe will not feel that fear from me. The moment that I acknowledge the fear, I am now, even the intellectual acknowledgement, is allowing this soul process to start taking place. The soul process is, firstly, I start having intellectual acknowledgements and then realizations intellectually and so forth, and then I get to the intellectual truth of it, and then I start having emotional realization, soul-based realization, soul-based things happening with regard to the same fear, and eventually I'll get to the cause of the fear and it will be gone. Now, I can't do that in one day, generally. You can in a lot of processing with different fears, but you're not going to do it with all of your fears in one day. Impossible. And in fact, if we attempted the process, we'd probably be very damaged in the process in that day. But we can at least acknowledge the fear in the moment, and we can also stop telling ourselves that it's true. Stop telling ourselves that our fear has truth in it. Myself and Mary were discussing this quite a lot yesterday as well, like how we see a lot of people telling themselves that their fears are real. So in other words, let's say I'm afraid of my child being hurt, like, you know, walking across the street. Now that fear may appear real because there's a lot of cars going back and forth and all sorts of things could happen. There's, you know, so I tell myself, oh, it's all these terrible things could happen to my child. So I've got to lock my child in the house so that it never goes across the road. Right? There's my fear now has dictated the action to lock my child in the road because I'm unwilling to feel all of my fears about my child being run over and perhaps die and all those, you know, being injured and all those kind of fears that most parents have about their children. And in that moment that I'm shutting down those fears, that in denial, I am now controlling my child. So my child now is living a life as a direct result of my fear that I'm unwilling to feel. But the instant that I intellectually acknowledge, this is just a fear. I'm afraid of death. I'm afraid of injury. I'm afraid, you know, I list of all those fears that I'm afraid of in this one interaction where I'm afraid of my child being hurt. And I start going, okay, I'm not going to be able to process all of these fears today. Right? But I can stop telling myself they're true. I can stop telling myself that they're real. I can start telling myself that they're actually just false expectations appearing real, which is what fear really is. I can tell myself that instead. And what we find a lot of people doing is they're not doing that. They're telling themselves that their fears are real still. And while you do that, you will definitely act upon your fears because what you're doing is you're justifying your fears to yourself. And one of the most damaging things you can do with your fear is to justify it to yourself. So I justify keeping my child locked in my house because of my fear about the child getting injured. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Now, so we can firstly intellectualize and go, I acknowledge I have that fear. But the second thing I need to also do is to stop justifying that fear to myself. Now, if I stop justifying the fear to myself, I have a chance of feeling it. But when I justify it to myself, I'm taking an angry position about my fear. I'm saying, no, I don't have to feel this fear. I reckon that thing's true. I believe that that is true. I know that's true. I've seen that true in my whole life. My whole life's been an example of that truth. And I every time I hit the table going, that's true, I am justifying in my anger my fear to stay inside of me. And while my fear stays inside of me, I have no hope of ever releasing it while I'm justifying it staying inside of me. Does that make sense?
And it does go out into my child or my husband.
Yeah. And it's the justification of the fear that is perhaps the worst projection you could ever give to your environment, and particularly to your children. Justifying to them, Mummy's afraid, but she has good reason to be afraid. Do you see? Instead of going, Mummy's afraid, and she has no reason to be afraid. You see, that has a very different influence on our child, doesn't it? Than Mummy's afraid and she has good reason to be afraid. You see, that tells our child a completely different thing. Yeah. And it also tells ourselves something completely different too, because in this first place, when I go, I'm justified having this fear, when I do that, I'm actually telling myself that I'm justified to retain it. I'm justified keeping it inside of me as a belief. And while I'm justifying that to myself, I am definitely going to act upon my fear every time. But the instant I say to myself, no, none of my fears are justified. None of them. Not even my fear of death is justified. Because there's no such thing as death. So that even that fear is not justified. None of my fears are justified. When I tell myself that, now I'm starting to have the ability to feel the fears, whatever they are. Right? There's a higher likelihood that I'll let myself feel my fear while I'm telling myself that it's not justified to have this fear anymore. Does it make sense? Yeah. So my feelings are, take those steps. The intellectual acknowledgement that the fear is a fear. The second step is to no longer justify your fear to yourself or to anyone in your environment. Don't justify your fears anymore. And while that might sound quite clear, it's actually quite hard to do. To give you an example, many of you ladies go shopping every week, right? You've got children, taking them shopping, maybe. So you take your child shopping, and your child wants something that's really expensive to purchase. Right? What's your fear? If I put that thing in my shopping trolley, I've now just spent 20 more euros. That's one of your fears. But if I don't put that thing in my trolley, my child's going to scream in front of everybody. That's another fear. You follow me? Now, I can justify both of those fears to myself by making all sorts of compromises. I can say, oh, my child, I won't get that for my child, because it's too expensive. That's justifying the first fear, the fear of it costing too much. But instead what I'll do is I'll go and get it a lolly so it doesn't scream in the shop. I'll go and get some sweets so it doesn't scream in the shop. That's justifying the second fear that you have of your child screaming in front of other people. Can you see? And we barely even think about it. It's just like bang, bang, and it's done. And it's barely even thought about. So to actually do this, no longer justifying your fear, is much harder than talking about it. But the beauty of doing it is that you will confront every single fear very rapidly, and you will feel it very rapidly if you do it. If you no longer justify to yourself your own fears, you will very rapidly feel what your fears are. That's the beauty of that process. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Does that answer your question there? Yeah. Yeah. Katarina?
So what is at play, and it just happened to me half hour ago, when I have a fear, and it actually happens, and I'm like, I was just thinking of that, and it just happened right in front of my eyes.
Most
my
of
child.
That's the beauty of your fears. Most of them will actually happen. Because they need to happen for you to confront that fear. Can you see? Your soul will create what you're afraid of in order for you to release this fear from you. How else are you going to release it? Now, what most people do is they go, see, what I was afraid of happening happened, so I'm right. What is that doing? It's justifying your fear.
Yeah, that's what I was asking, because what I was afraid just happened, and I'm like, I was just afraid of that.
Exactly. And now you have proof of it before your very eyes that you were needed to be afraid of that. When in reality, what you actually have proof of before your very eyes is that you have that emotion that God, through this law of attraction, instantly brought to you the moment you thought about it, bang, there was the fear in play.
It happened immediately.
And you have the now the ability to feel this fear instead of justifying it. But most people don't do that. What they do is justify it.
For me, it's like starting to view the law of attraction as a gift, like seeing, like my whole feeling coming to Greece, I was talking to AJ about it, is, babe, I just feel so low about myself. I don't feel like I have anything to offer. Now, in the space of, I don't know how long we've been talking, I've had three really big triggers on that. And instead of like going, that's it, I'm not doing any more talks, I'm just sitting here going, wow, thanks. Like, that's an opportunity to, like, I'm feeling that feeling now, you know? So that's a gift. Like, it's hard to sometimes view things that trigger our fear and pain as gifts, but I'm beginning to make that transition, I think, you know, that it's maybe a gift that I'm being offered. Yeah. It gives you faith in God's love as well, like, yeah.
I feel that if you have a fear of something and you're instantly seeing it in front of you happen, then firstly, that's telling me, boy, my soul is really powerful.
I want change, yeah.
Secondly, it's telling me, that what just Mary just said, that I want change so much that all I've got to do is feel about a fear, and bang, it happens straight away. Help to actually let me get into it.
Especially with Peter, every time I'm afraid of something about him, it will happen within minutes or seconds.
So if you instead practice just feeling, oh, I feel fear, you know, let and feel the fear. You know, fear feels very sickly inside of you generally. Like, it's a real sickening feeling inside of you. Fear, particularly terror, is a very sickening, terrible feeling inside of you. It feels like that. So if you try practicing next time you have a fear of something happened to Peter, instead of going, oh, something's going to happen, and then again it happens, go feel the terror inside of you instead, and then notice what happens. You'll find it won't happen.
I only recently understood that I'm actually terrified of everything. I thought I wasn't before. I thought I was a really strong woman, confident. I'll do everything. And it's just, so now I'm actually afraid of everything, and that's never going to end, because everywhere I turn, I'm afraid of everything, of every action I take, of every person, of every incident. I'm afraid to walk in crowds, afraid of this, of it. I never thought I was before. And so I'm just afraid a lot these days.
Yeah. And when you are soft to that fear, Katarina, then you won't even be afraid that it never end, because you're sort of in the process of experiencing the fear, and you know as you're doing that the change is happening. Yeah.
But I also noticed that, which I hadn't noticed before, that I go out of body like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't still...
That's how you
I
used to manage
it.
Your fear.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, I only noticed it now, when I'm like, who did this? What happened? How did this come about? Where was I?
Yeah. And that's how the majority of people manage fear, by going out of their body.
Most people walk around totally out of their
body.
And my life is exactly the same. I thought I was independent, world traveller, go anywhere, do anything, I'm fine, it's all good. This trip, we get on the plane and I'm out of body. You know, I'm just out of body for 7 hours because I'm petrified.
We sat next to a guy who was just sexually projecting at men and women. Like, and he had a lot of pretty...
He's obviously had a pretty hard life.
Pretty hard life, obviously. And he had a lot of emotions about needing approval from men and women. And to get it, to have sex... Plus, he's had a very sexually promiscuous life. And so he's so used to getting all of his sexual needs expressed in that way. And he sat right next to us for 7 hours.
And I just, like, I'm having that same experience with fear of just feeling how I'm afraid of everything. Well, not everything, but so many things. And how I feel so acutely now when I'm out of body. But I used to exist in that state and think it was normal. So it's a positive thing that you're actually it's a positive thing that you're actually noticing. Oh, I'm not in my body. Like that's a step forward because you can take action to get back in then.
Yeah, because I didn't even understand what out of body meant.
Yeah.
I heard people talking about it. I had no clue. I had no desire to know
exactly
what it was or what it meant. I thought I had another impression in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
But the minute like Nina suggests, okay, breathe. And I felt it helpful to actually tap my solar plexus because I'm actually, like, if I touch me somewhere, then it's easier.
Yeah.
And then I'm realizing, wow, I wasn't here for this whole, like, 20 hours of the day. I'm not in my body.
Yeah.
And then I sleep and I'm not in my body.
And not in your body then either.
So it's like, well, where have I been? Where do I go? How does my life pass me? And I look at people in the eye and I don't recognize who they are.
Yeah. Yeah, the going out of body is a huge problem on the planet, actually. And it also causes us to no longer experience our life anymore. And it is a big problem with spirits as well, because when you're out of body, they can actually use your body quite a lot. So, you know, that's why many people, when they go out of body, the spirits come in and use their body to do whatever. You know, so often persons do this and do that and do this and do that, and you go through the day going, why did I do that for? Why did I do that for? You know, it's because most of the time you weren't even connected to your own life. And one of the things that happens a lot on the divine love path when you're following it is that you go through this initial phase of really like loving the path. You know, it's so fascinating and there's all this truth and it's so wonderful and you feel all these lovely emotions and then you get to the place where you realize, actually, most of my life I'm not living. And from that moment on, it's often quite difficult because you start reconnecting with your body, and in reconnecting with your body, you start reconnecting with all of your body's aches and pains. You start noticing how big or little it is. You start noticing how afraid you are of being hurt. You start feeling a lot of fears that you weren't aware of before. You become more conscious of everybody's emotions around you, and wow, you know, like how many people have actually got really serious, dark emotions. You start going, whoa, like this feels really bad today here, you know. We arrived in Amsterdam Airport, and whoa, just the heaviness of the materialism there was so tangible that it was difficult to stay in your body and be in the airport. Does that make sense? Like,
yes.
Because
yes.
of that emotion. And you start feeling and becoming very, very sensitive to all these things. And then you start feeling, this is just making me feel worse. My life is feeling worse. But actually, what's happening is you're going through this transition of actually learning to actually feel the environment that you're living in, rather than like staying away from the environment you're living by going out of your body. We made the comment the day before, it was yesterday we went down the beach,
yep.
Or the day before when we walked down, wasn't it?
Yep.
The day before we walked down the beach, we were walking along the beach just feeling this really heavy sexual oppression type of feeling emotions, which are down on your beaches here in Greece. And
sorry, he's not suggesting that. He's
never noticed that.
I'm saying it categorically. And And what I said to Mary was, you know, most of the women on this beach would be afraid to even put on a bikini if they could feel how many of these men feel like raping them. Does that make sense? So in other words, most of the women were so detuned from that feeling being projected, or they were in a codependent addiction about that feeling being projected at them, that they didn't even notice how potentially violent that emotion was towards them. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But then, so you imagine you're down in that environment and you're not even conscious of all of that emotion, and then you start connecting to yourself. So in other words, instead of being out of your body, you start connecting to your body. And then you start feeling, this guy's looking at me, that guy's looking at me, these guys are looking at me, they're undressing me, how's this feeling? You start, and can you see, your panic would start to rise, and you'd start to worry about your own safety and welfare, and so forth. And so this is the reason why we go out of body a lot, right? Because we don't want to feel the environment so much.
Or we don't like ourselves. That was the case for me. I wasn't liking myself, and I didn't want to feel my own stuff, so I was always out of body.
True, yep.
So the minute I started bringing everything in and wanting to feel who I am, all these fears appear that I thought I didn't have.
Exactly. But you've always had them.
This is what I'm realizing. Yep. I've always had these fears. I was not in tune at all with myself.
Exactly.
So I didn't realize I was projecting this way or that way. Myself.
Now, to me, that's a better place.
Katrina,
Katarina, it's a better place than knowing or thinking that you don't have any fears.
Yeah.
You see, but most people in the world would tell you that's a worse place.
Because at first it doesn't feel like a better place.
No, it doesn't.
I'm actually realizing, I feel hostility from everywhere when I'm in a crowded place,
mm-hmm.
like airports, as you said. I left my body both times I went there,
yep.
and I was terrified about everybody around me.
Yep.
And I travel 2 or 3 times a year to the States and back, and it was nothing. It was like, oh, it's a breeze.
And you did that alone, didn't you, sometimes? Or just alone with the kids?
Most of the time I was alone.
Yeah.
Most of the time. And I thought I wasn't afraid of anything. And I was actually terrified to set foot in the airport. And I was feeling and I was smelling everybody. And I was smelling people. And I was seeing.
Yep.
Yeah.
And that's a good thing.
Yeah, can you see how that's logically actually even a better place to be? Because you're more in tune with your environment. When you're wandering around...
Myself.
You're more in tune with yourself and you're more in tune with the environment when you're feeling these feelings.
By being in tune with yourself, you are naturally more in tune with your environment.
Yeah.
And that's a good thing, because you can make a more informed choice when you are in touch with the people and the emotions around you, than the choices you would make when you're out of body. Because when you're out of body, you can't feel the difference between, you know, Cavill, Eva, and Glennis on the airplane.
Or even more pronounced,
they're
between
Cavill
and a sexual predating rapist.
Yeah.
You won't be able to feel the difference.
Yeah. Whereas if you're in your body, you go, whoa, I'm feeling afraid, but I can feel the difference.
So do I want to spend time chatting him up on the airplane?
Yeah.
No, I don't. Do you know what I mean? Like. So this is where I feel it will help you make a lot more informed decisions. When I say informed decisions, decisions that are based upon the reality of your environment rather than what you imagine your environment to be. See, most of us are making decisions every moment of the day based on what we imagine our environment is rather than the reality of it.
It's not even what we imagine, it's what we hope.
It's what we hope.
Yeah.
It's what we hope.
It's what we hope. And it's also
answered stuff about God, why I could not connect. Because I was so not wanting to connect with what I feel.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
I didn't want to feel all these fears. And the minute I started wanting to feel the fears, then I had maybe trickles of desires to get to know who God is or get to know His name.
Yeah.
Like I've never asked, what is your name?
Yeah.
What do they call you? To me, it was just God.
Yeah.
I'm like, God, this far away.
He or she has a name?
Person.
Well, I don't feel so, but obviously Katarina does.
Well, I felt like I wanted to know God better.
Yep.
And I was asking, what can I call you?
When you say, what can I call you? Yep.
Yeah.
That's
a
good question to ask
God,
right?
Are you called something? And now I didn't...
Moses asked that question and God said, I am.
happen.
I didn't get like a name as a reply, of course, but I just felt a desire, and to me that was massive to want to feel a desire to ask even God, what are you called?
Well, it's one of the first things we ask people when we want to get to know them, isn't it?
But often, like you say, Katarina, it's like the more detuned I am from myself, the more detuned I am from everyone around me, the more detuned I am with God, the more detuned I am from safety, ironically. So we actually view going out of body as safe. The reality is it's the most unsafe thing you could ever consider doing.
Because you can't make conformed choices. You can't feel your environment.
Right. And it's not you.
Yeah.
And it's not even you. And but then you're like, how did this happen? And I didn't know.
Yeah.
While I was there.
And so with breathing, you can go through that.
Yep.
The first thing you do.
Breathing is one way to connect with your feelings and one way to connect with, but you need to be prepared to feel all of your fears, like Katarina said too, you know, feel everything. And feeling everything means feeling everything.
Is it possible for some fears to be imposed by spirits?
Many of them are, but you'd be willing to feel them as well.
Yeah?
Yeah, of course. Because you want to feel everything in your environment. See, you're the safest when you know everything around you. Now, knowing it doesn't mean thinking that you hope that it's like this. I mean knowing it in the sense of feeling the truth of it. So that means feeling the truth of what spirits are connected to me right now.
I have a feeling, it's a bit more personal, I have a feeling like I'm going to lose a limb with my bike.
You on a motorbike?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's not like it's my fear. I feel it's not my fear because I don't have that fear anymore.
So you feel there's a spirit with you who's lost their limb?
No, there's a
spirit. Causing me this.
There's a spirit with you telling you you're going to.
Yeah.
So if you are not in fear, what would you do? Well, like if somebody told me, I know for certain that you're going to lose a leg if you do this particular thing, and I'm not in fear, but I want to keep my leg, what would I do?
Stop doing this?
Yeah.
But I look my back.
Ah. So in other words, you're willing to sacrifice your leg?
No.
For your bike? No, I'm saying you are, right at this moment.
Yes, but this spirit is not mine. It's someone.
Yeah, but it's very rare for a spirit to tell you something's going to happen to you without you feeling fear. So you're saying you don't feel fear that it's going to happen. The spirit's telling you that it's going to happen. It's very rare for a spirit to tell you something that's going to happen without you feeling fear about it, without it not happening. In other words, what the spirit is predicting is highly likely to occur. Do you understand? Under the circumstances you've given me. The circumstances being that you don't have any fear of it occurring.
I thought it was a devilish spirit.
I don't think so.
What AJ's saying is, the two conditions that a spirit would tell you something like that is, one, if you already have an existing fear about the bike or losing a limb, and so they would want to heighten your fear and say, yeah, it's going to happen,
just
you're going
to
lose
just
a limb.
Just to make you stop.
And then you'd get so afraid you might stop, or you'd just be in the fear of it.
But that's not happening in this case.
The other condition is that it is a spirit who is saying out of love or concern for you, hey, you could lose a limb. Like, I can see in the future you're going to lose a limb.
Do you see? And he's saying to you, really, that your love of your bike is stronger than your desire to actually do something about this particular feeling he's telling you. Can I make a comment about bikes in Greece? Just generally. It's a maniac world out there. I'm surprised any bike riders are alive, to be frank. I observed in between our trip from the airport to our brought us home. And I observed in that space, how many kilometres is that? 20,
25
kilometres. Nearly 100 accidents that could have potentially occurred if one person had made one different decision. And most of them involved motorcycle riders. Just one person, like where I could see that the person was not aware that the bike rider was there, mm-hmm. present, and if they just made a different decision in that moment, the bike rider would be dead in many cases, or severely injured. And that's sort of, and this is not a fear I'm talking about, this is just a factual thing of what I was feeling from the owners of the cars and the owners of the bikes while we're driving down. And I made a comment to Mary about it, that I don't know whether I'd ride a motorbike in Greece as a result of that, you know, because of just the amount of unknown things that could potentially occur to a bike rider. You must have a lot of bike riders in hospital here in Greece,
yeah.
I would have thought.
I've hardly come in bikes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, if
you
drove it locally, then they would, somebody would probably beat you.
Even lawfully?
If you follow the law.
Yeah.
And stay where you're supposed to, like in the States, they do stay behind the car or wear a helmet. People will get so upset with you.
Yeah.
That
I
you're
know.
Taking the space.
You're taking the space.
Yeah.
They think the bike takes the space if it's behind.
Yeah,
the bike.
No, that's the feeling. The projection coming from the car owners and, it's a combination of things. It's not just the bike riders.
They just expect you to do this.
Yes, yes.
Sort of wheels and stuff.
And it's an unwritten rule to, when you're the first one on the red light, not to stand in the middle of the line on the side because the car might, crash into you as a bike.
Yeah, no,
according to the law, it's like the same space. Occupies the same space.
Yes,
yeah.
I know. You can feel. I'm just commenting on the emotions of the car drivers and the emotions of the motorcyclists, and combining those two sets of emotions together, there's just hundreds of potential accidents happening in a 25, kilometer trip. Just potential accident, and so it wouldn't surprise me that your hospitals have quite a lot of motorcycle accident victims in the hospital. So my feeling is that you have a spirit with you warning you of this. Now, what you do with any warning from a spirit is based on your own choices and decisions. And I've often given the example of a man who was warned by a spirit that he was going to have a very, very severe car accident. And then the man who was relating this said, should I tell him that he's going to have the car accident? And I said, yeah, of course. It doesn't mean he's going to have the car accident, because it just depends on the choice that he makes, right? And the choice that he made was to ask why. And the spirit said, because the whole front end of your car brake system is all going to fail very soon. And because all of the trips he was doing were on 100 kilometer an hour roads, he was going to have a very, very severe accident as a result. Now, the guy jacked up his car, and sure enough, all of the brake fluid, hoses in the front of the car were all almost ready to break. He replaced them all, and then the spirit said, yeah, there's no potential of you having an accident anymore.
I'm gonna have to check out my bike.
I doubt whether it's because of brake on the bike. So what I'm saying is, the spirit is giving you an opportunity.
May I ask something else about the spirits?
Can I just say a few more things about the opportunity?
Also, I
want to
say something.
Yeah, and Mary, want to say something about too. The opportunity is given to you from a loving spirit. He's not connecting to your fear, so therefore he must be in a state of love. And he's giving you an opportunity to make a choice about your life. He's giving you a warning, and it's up to you whether you respond to that warning or not. The reason why you are not responding to the warning at the moment is because of your love of how it feels when you ride your motorcycle. Does that make sense? That's the reason why you're not responding to the warning. So my feelings are to feel about your motorcycle, feel about how much you love it, and feel about why you love it so much. Does that make sense? What it gives you, what the feeling is when you ride it.
Actually, about 2 or 3 weeks ago, someone, put the bike underneath my house, under my house, my veranda, and there was a guy who stole my mirrors. I thought it was a kind of warning,
So there's another warning.
So there's two warnings.
I thought maybe it was something because I love my bike that much, so maybe I have to deal with that emotion that someone stole my, made the mirrors of my bike or my bike.
Well, in a sense, it is about how much you love your bike, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's an addiction in there. That's what AJ's trying to point out.
But it didn't feel like it was like for losing my bike. It was like for what you said.
Yeah, like if you were in Australia and in the wide open country, my in Australia, and you loved riding a motorcycle, why wouldn't you? Like, really? But if you're in Greece, in the middle of Athens, where often the traffic is just bedlam, man,
yeah.
It's like, isn't it? And you can't predict what any of these people are going to do. Like, and the amount of rage in most of the drivers that I've observed here is pretty intense, like you know there's just one woman I just remember saw yesterday, she's going beep beep, you know, beep beep, you know, and they weren't stopping, they were keeping on going past, and she was trying to barge in, you know, and let them in, and in the end she, like, her face was getting more and more angry, and these people were getting angry, and one person went right up to the front of her car, stopped in front of her car, looked at her and goes, what are you doing, you know, like, and then dries up, but she's still doing it, you know, trying to show me, and just no patience at all on her behalf, and you've got all of these emotions in play here, and I think a lot of it is because of frustration, right, in terms of frustration about, you know, what's happening environmentally and socially and also economically, but obviously, when you have a spirit giving you warnings and you don't feel that it's based upon any fears you have, my suggestion is to actually consider the warning very, like, you know, as you would consider something that had a lot of weight, you know.
Give that advice.
Give it good consideration. Because spirits can see the future to a large degree based on what's happening in our life and
at this moment,
and while it may not happen, the event may not happen, and often spirits will not tell you about these kind of events unless there is a high likelihood of them happening.
I just wanted to talk about that a little bit, about spirits giving us messages about things happening, because it is important that we discern what's happening. So for example, if I'm sitting here, I'm in my body and I'm connected to what's happening, and AJ, who I don't know, comes up to me and says, don't eat the cake because it's poisoned. Okay, for example. Now if I'm connected to myself, I will
No, we don't want
to. It's okay. I'm sure. If I'm connected
to Mary's got a very powerful soul.
Yeah, I can't believe it. If I'm connected to myself, then I'm in a humble space. So I'm not invested in this other person. I'm humble, and I want to feel if there's truth in what this person's saying to me. Then I'm going to feel them first, aren't I? I'm going to open and feel, is this
person... Feel the character of this person.
Yeah. Is this playing on one of my fears? Is this someone trying to manipulate a fear that I have inside me? So if I'm humble...
Are they just joking with me?
Yeah. Are they trying to play a game with me? So if I'm humble, I'll feel myself, and I'll open myself to feel that person. And immediately I have more information in the situation, don't I? Is it, like, for yourself, you've thought about it and gone, no, I'm not afraid about that, so it must be someone else. And you can take that a step further and ask, okay, I want to feel, what's the nature of this person telling me? Do they feel like they have a regard for me? Do they feel like
they feel love for you?
It feels very far, far away from me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm suggesting if you open yourself and you ask in a time when you're feeling quite connected to yourself, to feel them a little more, I think your guides will help you with that as well. But the second thing I would do, and with a person is in front of me, I would ask them a question. Why are you saying that to me? You know?
Yeah.
And you can do that with the spirit.
And you've got quite a number of mediums here present as well in your group.
Actually, the next question I wanted to ask is, was that I had my first channeling about 2 weeks ago. It was very strong feeling. So I had one with Katerina about a month ago, and it was exactly this, but it was not me being alone with the spirit, right? It was me and Katerina. It was very, very intense, that experience. And after a couple of weeks, I was at my house, and I was, you know, just fooling around my laptop, and suddenly something came onto me, and I started writing, and I have it on in my car. Actually, I forgot to bring it up. And it was, I'm not sure if it was true. I mean, it's the first experience I ever had. Mm-hmm. And you're telling me that about the bike thing, and, I'm not sure how to believe or how to make sure that this is spirit talking to me.
It's the same with almost everything you investigate. And that is, allow the investigation without coming to conclusions until the conclusions become self-evident.
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, allow yourself to continue investigation, until such a point in time that you feel quite certain whether this is what is happening or not. You see, what most people do is they preclude the investigation. So they try to make the decision up front because they go, oh, do I trust this person or don't I trust this person? Well, you don't have to actually make that choice at this point.
How can you investigate a spirit?
The same way as you investigate every person you ever met, by having an interaction with them, listening to them, writing from them, like you have done, feeling them in particular, like as Mary suggested.
And it's important that you're feeling, you work on feeling yourself.
Feeling yourself, feeling them.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, he said some things that maybe I don't want to accept them, that's why.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
So what are those things?
I don't want
to. No, that's okay.
Maybe in person, but...
Yeah, they were. And that's the thing, is you see, oftentimes a person who loves us will say things to us that we don't want to accept. And often it's people who don't love us that only say things to us that we can accept. Does that make sense?
Because we exist in this state of addiction. So if someone really loves me, they'll challenge my addiction, won't they?
Yeah. True.
Yeah. And so, as we were talking about before, say with the motorbike, you're going, yeah, I think I've got some addictions with the motorbike. So immediately, you know, someone's telling me I maybe shouldn't be riding the motorbike. Okay, well, maybe there's a loving intent here because I know I'm not in a state of love around the bike.
Yeah. And it wasn't something in my head like my mom, like stay with the bike and stuff. It was something like for far away, but
yeah.
I couldn't tell the intention of that.
Yeah. And the key is to investigate the intention of the person by further communication, by allowing yourself to feel their feelings. Well, why are they indicating to you that there were, maybe they can give you a picture, for example, of what may happen, for example.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, what was the picture? Do you mind describing?
The first, actually, it was not a picture, it was like, it was me flying around over an island.
Yeah,
and it was so bright and shining. I was flying over the sea, and I lost my left shoe.
Yeah,
went back down to the sea to find it, and I couldn't find it, and just ended up on that island that I was flying by. And I couldn't see many people around me, but the ones who talked to me with love. They reminded me some of my friends.
Yeah,
a very good friend of mine. And she told me, oh, don't worry, you don't need this shoe.
This is in the second channeling, or the one about the
dream after?
It's a dream
after. A dream after.
You won't need this shoe.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
But it was loving, it wasn't like...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how did you feel about it?
I woke up.
Yeah, like quiet.
Yeah, I realized that I'm in a state of dreaming.
Yeah.
I'm dreaming, and
Yeah. I feel like you're getting quite a number of indications in a row.
Actually, I feel like, you know, we have been talking in my sleep quite a lot.
As we do.
I don't know why.
Why wouldn't I? We talk when we're awake.
Yeah,
it's like... When it comes to indications of these kind of events, the key is to ask yourself, well, am I afraid and is my fear being played upon, as Mary has already suggested. But in this case, your fear isn't being played upon. In fact, if anything, they're giving you a message that is completely the opposite of what you'd like to hear because of how much desire you have to keep riding your bike. And, you know, it's going to get down to just whether you can trust the information or not as to, and what your choice and decision would be as a result of that information, really, as to what happens. And if something does happen where you do, you know, have an accident, then you at least know that the communication was quite accurate. But you've got to ask yourself that question, do I want to wait?
I believe that they have some, you know, stronger desires than others than riding my bike at the moment.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually, they groomed since the past month.
Yep.
Actually, I'm doing nothing but listening to your DVDs and,
yep.
You know.
Yeah, I feel for yourself, what I would be doing, I know when I rode bikes a bit, it was a lot about, and my father in particular has, my father loves bikes, he's got a bike of his own, he's got a, and my brother owns a bike as well, and both powerful bikes, you know, 900cc bikes, and they both have the same emotion that I had to work my way through, and that is this emotion of feeling the sense of freedom and control, which is very, very big when you've got a bike. You know, you can do things with the bike that...
Which is exactly the opposite.
Yeah. You don't have those, or... Sorry?
I used to feel like I have that sense of control and freedom, but no.
You don't now. Yeah.
And that changed like a couple of weeks ago.
Right, yeah.
Oh, you know that.
Thank you. So, when did it change? Can you see it was when you started?
Yeah, after my time.
And you, and also after you started investigating other desires?
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of times we do things that are reckless, shall we say, because of the suppression of our real desires.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was it. Yeah, actually I wanted to do like skydiving and stuff.
Yeah. Skydiving's fun, eh?
Yeah. No,
but
right now I don't want to do it.
Don't want to do it, yeah.
But often though, people can become addicted to those kind of extreme sports, extreme experiences.
Men in
because
particular.
I quit
so
karate,
numb.
Actually.
Yeah.
I quit, you know, practicing karate because I had that feeling that some people would like to harm me.
Yeah. Yeah.
In there.
Yeah. You see a lot of men addicted to extreme sports. And it's because of the fact that there's a lot of their other desires not being satisfied.
I want to add, so if he doesn't have the fear of losing a leg, how can this still happen? Like, is it maybe another emotion that will...
Yeah, it'll be other emotions driving the event. Yep.
I feel maybe because the mirrors were stolen.
Yep.
And the left leg has to do with spiritual direction, that he doesn't want to look back.
Yes, but there's also, you think about the left, it has a lot to do with the feminine. So the question I'd be asking myself is about how am I feeling about the relationships with women in my life? And
rage,
sorry?
Rage.
Yeah.
And also it has to do with some spiritual things that are happening in them.
And can I also indicate to you that another part of this event is going to be, it's about, a lot of the reasons why you rode a bike were about rebellion with your mother. They were sort of anger with your mother always being fear, you know, and feeling in the end like, no, mum, no, I just want to get out of under this fear rule, you know. And there is a relationship between what side of the body would be affected through an accident, and the mirrors, and all of these are all law of attraction, all related to mum, I feel, and the past. And the kick is to work your way through them.
And also, I cannot accept, you know, the spiritual changes that are occurring to me. Funny, I thought, you know, I'm on the path since last September, so it's about 9 months.
Yeah.
But most of the changes that I have experienced and are in the past month.
And that's often the same for most people, because we go through sort of like a honeymoon period where we still want to live our own life, the way we used to live it, but just incorporate this new truths into it, right? And then after a while we realized that actually that doesn't work very well.
And actually did what you suggested to one of your latest videos that came on YouTube, that you can experiment for 1 month, stay off for, I couldn't stay off more than 12 days. But it doesn't feel like I was off. I never was off.
Yeah. And it's great to experiment. Like God's given us this beautiful universe to experiment with the laws and experiment with the truths that we learn, and we can very rapidly determine truth if we're willing to experiment. The majority of people have trouble because they're not willing to experiment. They're in so much fear that they want to be told the truth rather than feel about it. And when we're unwilling to experiment, that's when it takes much, much longer for us to progress.
I never believed that you are who you say you are.
Yeah.
And until I saw a video of yours about faith, it was last year's video, which you cried while you were talking.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm still convinced about who you are.
Yeah.
You say you are, but I feel I am now. I feel I am, but. I wasn't willing to accept all those truths you were saying, just like you were saying. But I feel that's for everybody, that okay, we experiment what you say, no matter who you are. If this is the point,
if we throw out the Jesus thing for a moment, and you were just listening to somebody else who was talking about spiritual truths, anybody. Like, you know, I don't know who's popular here with spiritual truth. Have you got people locally here or in Athens? No. Like, you know, I suppose around the world there's people like, you know, Deepak Chopra and Wayne Dyer and Eckhart Tolle and, you know, all these different people that you hear things from that are written about in books and so forth. With every single one of them, if he's not saying he's Jesus, you'd just experiment, wouldn't you? So why not just do the same with me? Like, I feel the main reason why people don't do the same with me is because they instantly have that issue of, oh, he's saying he's Jesus, so I can't really trust him right from the beginning. And
this morning I was looking at my mirror before I come here, and I had a vision of, like, my mom meeting Jesus.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, Jesus. And I said, no.
Jesus doesn't like that very much.
Yeah, but this kind of attitude has been imposed to us.
Yep.
For the holy and divine that we should worship, and it was something about this that you have also said.
Yeah.
And you've said many things, by the way, it's worth living by.
Yeah.
We want people, other people, tell us. No matter whether they're holy or not, but they do, so that we can, we don't have the responsibility for our actions.
Exactly. Yeah. And my concern for many people who have this sort of worshipful attitude towards, I know they don't have it towards me generally, but they do towards Jesus, their Jesus, if you like.
Yeah.
And my concern for them is that. A worshipful attitude doesn't actually retain any self-responsibility generally. So what happens is that they don't understand the principle that is actually written in their own Bible, which is, you know, you will reap what you sow. They don't really get that principle. And yet it's a principle of life, you know, that we do need to understand. And so this is the beauty of experimentation. If you experiment with what you sow, then you're going to get different results you can measure with what you reap.
I believe you were your Jesus. The minute I thought of you as the brother.
Yeah, yeah.
Not as holy.
Yeah. And, and that's good. Because I'm still pretty. One of my injuries that I'm still in the process of working through is. Having had the 2,000 years of projections of people believing that I'm God, and that's been a pretty difficult feeling for me to actually I feel very rejectful of that projection, and so I'm always trying to keep it away from me, because it feels really bad to receive it, and so there's still a fair bit of grief in me about receiving that projection over a couple of thousand years, but also because that feeling in them has created many hardships for their own lives, you know, because in the end it meant that the real God, who they could have been connecting to all that time, hasn't been connected to by them, and so, you know, that there's a, I feel quite a lot of sadness that that has been the result
of what they've missed.
Of what they've missed, yeah.
And for their own, like, not the issue of personal responsibility to have not fully embraced. I'm not saying that people with attitude don't take any personal responsibility, but to fully embrace the issue of being responsible for my soul and my life and what's in it, that's beautiful. Like, it feels tough as we go into it, but it's a really beautiful state to live in, and I feel sad that so many people miss out on that because of a lot of Christian doctrine. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And in particular, the doctrine that my blood saves them.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen many Christians pass into the spirit world and then very, very quickly thereafter become so angry with God and with myself and so forth, because they believed in my blood saving them, but they didn't understand the law of compensation, for example. They didn't understand that what you sow, you will eventually reap. And so many of them, while they were on earth, had this viewpoint that they could keep on sowing badness, if you like, or sowing things that were, you know, immoral, and then not have to reap the consequence because they could just believe in my blood and then everything would be fine. And then they pass in the spirit world recognizing that everything's not very fine, and they're in a lot of condition of darkness and pain. And so I've seen many, many Christians pass in the spirit world in that condition of darkness and pain as a result of their belief systems on earth. And
I've seen them.
Yeah, I'll go after you. Is it time there everyone have a break?
Yeah.
Should we have munchies too?
Yeah.
That's it.
As we recover.